serves on the development committee for the Music Teachers National Association. Heather maintains a private studio in Centerville, Utah. And a fun fact about Heather is that one of her hobbies is to enter cooking and recipe contests. So get her up for a good lasagna. Our second speaker is Joy Morin, who is a teacher, pianist, speaker, and writer of a blog at colorinmypiano.com. She teaches students of all ages at her independent studio in Northwest Ohio. An active member of Music Teachers National Association, Joy has served in numerous capacities, most recently as VP for Affiliated Associations for the Ohio MTA and co-president of the Toledo Piano Teachers Association. And something personal and fun about Joy is that Joy was homeschooled for 5 years growing up and plays racquetball 3 times a week, more than some students practice. But please welcome Heather.
Thank you, Richard. I'm so honored to get the opportunity to share with you today my experience teaching beginning group piano classes. This past September, I had the opportunity to start teaching beginning group piano classes. Now, these classes are a little bit different than what I was used to teaching in the past, where I would teach private lessons and supplement it with group classes. This was exclusively group classes for beginning students between the ages of 7 and 10 years old. And when I explained this to some of my well-intentioned colleagues, this was their advice. Luckily for the 24 students that enrolled in my program, I chose not to listen to their advice, and today I'm here to share with you why it was an excellent idea and how you yourselves can implement group piano classes in your own studios. So I came up with a really simple four-step formula on how I started doing this program. First, I began with the end in mind. Second, business administration. Third, curriculum. And fourth, classroom management. Now, all of these slides I've included on your handout, the links, so you don't need to take notes. You will have access to all of these slides. The first, begin with the end in mind, came from Stephen Covey's book, 7 Habits. And this is a really important concept to remember before you start any new program. You want to know what you're planning on presenting to the classes, what the structure of the classes look like, and what the curriculum is that you want to base your program off of. And so to bring this to a personal level, why did I choose to do beginning group piano classes? And the main reason was because I was so tired of saying no. I was telling parents, I don't have space for your children. I have a lot of students, I have a very full private studio with a lot of younger siblings that were waiting in the wings, waiting for piano lessons, and I just couldn't accommodate them. There was a kinder music teacher in my community who every spring she would have a group of students who would graduate from her program, and every spring she would call me up and say, can you please take some of my students? And I would tell her no. I had a lot of students or a lot of parents that would contact me hearing about the RCM certificate program, which I do in my area, and they wanted their children to participate as well, and I would unfortunately have to tell them I just don't have the space. So that got me to thinking, how can I start saying yes to these people? And this is what I ended up doing, is coming up with some ideas. I started thinking about this about a year in advance, on what the structure of these classes would look like and how could I move some students around to accommodate a group class setting. Sorry, let's see here. And so I came up with some ideas on what I needed. I had some inventory ideas on what I already had and some things that I needed to get. And so I made an investment to start purchasing some things that I knew that I needed to have a successful group piano course. So what I originally had, the only thing that I had were 2 Kauai Grand pianos. which I decided they didn't need anymore. And that caused a lot of contention in my family. But I went out, and this is what I ended up creating. So originally, we had some sofas right here, a TV right here, and my son's favorite ping pong table right there. I got rid of it all so that I could have this lab. I purchased some electronic pianos, benches, posters, artwork, headphones. I didn't have a screen or a projector, and I knew that these were items that I would need in my group class setting. Some other items that I purchased as well. And so after I had the infrastructure in place, what I decided were what kind of class layout I wanted to create. And so I decided that I would teach students between the ages of 7 and 10 years old in a class of 6 to 8 students at a time. I would offer 3 classes a week, each class meeting once a week. The classes would meet for 14 weeks, for 50 minutes, and it would be a 2-semester course. So the objectives of my class, first of all, to have fun, because this isn't a group class setting, and these are students that would really enjoy taking piano lessons with their peers. The second is to make sure that the students are acquiring the familiarity of the items that a first-year piano student should acquire. And the last is to make sure that all of these students are prepared for the Royal Conservatory, the RCM Certificate Program Preparatory A assessments at the end of the school year. So this was a new concept in my area. People weren't used to hearing about group classes. They were used to enrolling their children in private lessons. And so this was an educational opportunity for me to share with parents what exactly a group class setting would look like. And so thanks to Brian Chung's book, R&M Recreational Making, I had the opportunity to find some great bulleted points on what a group class setting should look like. And I shared these with the parents in our parent orientation meeting, which was held 2 weeks before the first classes began. So the second step in my four-part formula is business administration. And now this topic itself could be a whole semester's worth, and I'm just going to take 5 quick minutes to talk about these items. And the first topic is marketing. So having the opportunity to teach these classes gave me the opportunity to start saying yes to people. I told my parents, my students' parents, yes, I can accept your students in my studio, and please feel free to share my information with your friends and your family if you have any students or if they have any young children that would like to enroll in a beginning group piano class, to have them contact me. I was able to say yes to the kinder music teacher and let her know, yes, I could now accommodate her beginning group, her young graduates. I emailed my colleagues and I told them, if you have any students who you can't accommodate, send them to me for their first year of piano, and I will teach them and then send them back to you after they've had a year of piano. And from all of these items, I was able to get quite a few students enrolled in my program. For those of you who are friends with me on Facebook, I am so sorry. I know I bombarded you all with information on these classes last spring. And it was actually quite effective because there were quite a few students that enrolled in the program from Facebook and social media. I passed out a flyer in my spring recital to the parents and the grandparents, and I received some students from that as well. What was not so effective was advertising in my local newspaper, because I think that the parents of today's youth are not reading the newspaper. And so that was the wrong demographic to try and hit. But what was very effective is have any of you heard of Peach Jar? This is an excellent program that is a nation nationwide program where you can send an electronic flyer to Peach Jar and you can specify which schools you want that flyer to go to. So I had this flyer go to 6 of the community elementary schools that were in my surrounding area, and I received quite a few students from just those flyers that I had sent to the school. And the last is a website, which I'll be going over in just a moment. So this is the flyer that I put on Facebook. I sent through the e-flyer through Peach Jar, and also that went through to the newspaper. And so I had it so that the parents would ask a question, see what the benefit of why they should enroll on a certain day, and I told them that they would get their books for free. And I actually had priced in the cost of the books in the tuition so that it was still marketable for me. And then with my contact information. So I thought it would be good just so that you have a little bit of a sneak peek on exactly what these group classes look like. So I have this short 30-second clip. And I hope the sound works. In today's society, this is so important to have a website because that's how parents find the teachers that they want and the programs that they want their children to be involved in. And so I highly utilize my own website to share with the parents what my program was about. I included information about the classes, an academic calendar, an online registration form, a payment link, studio policies, and weekly assignments. So I'm just going to go through this really quickly. This is the landing page for my group classes, and it tells the parents a little bit more about the program. The beginning group piano calendar had the dates for the whole entire academic year so that the parents knew when the classes were and at what time the classes were being offered. I had an online registration, so I wasn't trying to do this all by hand. And this is where I collected the students' information, the parents' information, the class information on what classes the students wanted to enroll in, as well as photo permission, because Nan had actually told me several months ago that I would be doing this. And so I wanted to make sure that I was able to show these photos of these children. And then I have my studio policies, because of course the first question is always, how much is the tuition? And so instead of fielding all of those questions on the phone, I had them just go directly to my website where they were able to see how much it cost, what were my policies regarding makeups, and what if there was a refund. So any questions they might have. Now this is the page where I got the most hits, and this is the weekly assignment sheets. So in a group class setting, it's so important that even if the child doesn't show up for their classes, that they are still practicing to prepare for the next week's class. Because as a group setting, it's really important that they're all in line and that they're prepared for the group classes. And so I have these assignment sheets, and in fact, they're in your packets, I think on the second page, so you can see what one of the assignment sheets looks like. And this is the assignment sheet for just a couple of weeks ago. So it includes what pages the students should be doing on each of their in each of their books. Because this is a very shortened presentation, I'm just going to briefly go over accounting. I'm sure all of you already do accounting in your own studios. But the program that I use for accounting is QuickBooks, so that I can do online billing and track the expenses, the income, so that I can do my expense, my taxes. All of the payments are received through PayPal, Venmo, and through checks. And then the tuition was due at the beginning of the semester before the first class began. So communication with parents can be either a real-time saver or a real-time sucker, for sure. And so what I created in on my website, and for those of you that don't have a website, I just use WordPress. It's a free program and it's fabulous. It's very easy to use. But anytime a student would register, I had a letter that would auto-send to the parents with information on what class they registered for, the time of the class, and as well as information on the parent orientation, just so that they know that I received their registration form. The curriculum that I use in this program is the RCM certificate program, because that's what I use as a private for all of my private students, and I've seen the benefits of what it has done for them, so I knew that this would be a fabulous program for these beginning group piano classes as well. In your packets, you have the preparatory A curriculum, which basically goes over what a first-year piano student will be able to do by the end of their first year. And so my students that have gone through this program, or they're going through it because we're still in the middle of the second semester right now, is they've learned how to have basic reading skills. They're able to play pieces, several pieces by memory. They're able to play with correct hand and sitting position. They're able to read and clap rhythmic patterns. They are learning about technique and sight reading and simple ear training exercises. These are the materials that I used in the classes. So these right here are the books that my first semester books, these are my second semester books, and all of the students receive these books on their very first day of each of the semesters. So what I used, and you really you can use any of the books that you want, but for in my studio, what I used, the Music Tree book, book one, and then the Alfred's Premier Piano Course, book 1A and two, are 1A and 1B, the RCM Publishing Celebrate Theory Preparatory Level, and then the Piano Premier Course Flashcards. And then for the second year, we still use all of these except for the Premier Piano Course Book A. They completed that, and then they started doing the Book B. That, at that point, they were ready to start working on their four-star sight reading and ear test book, as well as their celebration series piano repertoire preparatory A level. I also implemented the RCM music theory apps and four-star tests. And then I also used the Sprout Beat worksheets, which are a really great resource for teachers. Instead of creating your own worksheets, you can just use these worksheets. They're great. Okay, this is the fun part of my presentation. Classroom management tips. So I thought I had it nailed down. I knew exactly how to do these group classes because I had prepared for a whole year. Well, that first day, I learned that I had made several critical mistakes. So I'm going to share these with you to hopefully help you if you decide to do these. These are some pitfalls to avoid. These are the cute, innocent-looking children that tossed me into the fiery furnace every week for 3 hours every week. They are pretty cute, but they are a handful. And it was my husband. I would be done teaching at the end of the day on Mondays and Tuesdays, and I would just be crying. I would be in tears, and my husband would need to talk me off of the ledge and let me know I can do this again for another week. And so classroom management tip number one, hire a teaching assistant. Originally I thought, easy, I can handle 8 students at a time, that's no problem. Well, when you figure that you have 8 students in a room with 8 pianos, it just spells disaster. So this is one of my Q 15-year-old private students. manage these balls of energy that are all constantly bouncing off of the walls. Tip number two, divide the classes. So after my first week, I knew that I needed to do something different. And so I decided to break the group from 8 at a time to 4 at a time. And this is what little Thomas, age 7, had to say about my new arrangement. Yes, I did try to split them up, but I didn't take him away from his friends. And so this is the way that I had broken out the program. Okay. So because I had two different rooms, I would spend the majority of my time in the keyboard lab working on repertoire and technique. And I had Mara, my teaching assistant, work on the ear training, sight reading, and theory. And so for the first 20 minutes, I would take, we split every 10 minutes, the kids would rotate through each of the different rooms. And so for me, the first 10 minutes, I was spending my time reviewing the materials that I had assigned the prior week, while Mara was working on their theory assignments that they were supposed to have finished. And those that had finished their theory assignments, then they got to do the Sprout Bead worksheets. For the next 20 minutes, I spent my time working with the students on their new materials, and then I had Mara working on whatever concept I felt like they needed to work on as a collective. So because all of these students are getting ready for their RCM certificate assessments, this was a class from 2 weeks ago. They're now starting to work on their pieces by memory. And so she was having them play their pieces by memory. And while they were doing that, she would be writing notes in their book on what they could do to improve. And their little peers were also giving their 2 cents on what they felt like their peers should do as well. Which is awesome because, as we all know, peer pressure means so much more than whatever a teacher or parent says. And they all knew the pieces because they were all playing the same pieces. And then the last part of the class, we would spend 10 minutes so that Thomas, age 7, would be happy. I let them all be together, and we would work on a group project together. So what we did in this class is we were working on mock exams with ear training, sight reading, and rhythm reading exercises. Anderson, age 9, taught me the following. Eliminate the temptation to change sounds on the keyboard. So after their second week of piano, all of the students to find that their keyboards had an addition, a little piece of paper taped to their keyboards, covering up the piano, the sound buttons. So they always get to play with the piano sound. That's the best solution. These fun friends taught me another fun tip, and that's to frequently change their seating assignments. Because they would become so chummy with one another, if I allowed them just to enjoy each other's company, we would not get anything else done. So I was frequently changing where their seating arrangement was on a weekly basis. As a collective, all of these students taught me the following. Utilize headsets. So I didn't realize how telling this picture was until I started preparing for this presentation. I just thought it was a nice picture, and then I just really looked at it a little bit closer, and I realized when I'm having a teaching moment with this cute little boy right here, what's happening with the rest of the class? This little girl's changing her sounds. This little girl's staring at the wall. These three children are collectively talking and having a good time together. So even if I took a split second to have a teaching moment with one student, I lost the rest. And so what I knew I needed to do was utilize headsets. So even if I did have to have those teaching moments, those other students can still stay engaged in practicing the things that I wanted them to be working on. So this program now has been going on for the past semester and a half. We have 7 more classes to go before these classes end. And what started out as a lot of uncertainty certainty whether I was going to continue these classes or not this next year. I've learned that this has been such a wonderful program, and now I'm faced with a new problem, and that's realizing that I can't keep them all as my own private students. There will be a whole new batch of students coming starting in September. But what I know that this program has done is that it has put these students on a good, strong foundation, a musical journey that will last them throughout their lives. And it also, throughout this journey, I learned some profound lessons as well. So thank you.